focusing on restoration, protection, and evaluation of habitats in Eastern Lake, Ontario. So we take this framework that the early life habitats and stages are an important component of management because this is essentially the front line of natural reproduction that can promote self-sustaining fisheries. In addition, both for species, specifically walleye that spawn in tributaries, these early life habitats can be disproportionately impacted by land use changes. This is a spawning habitat, a tributary of Eastern Lake, Ontario, and it's been substantially modified to be primarily agricultural with relatively little riparian habitat. And this just raises a bunch of concerns towards sedimentation and channelization, both of which can reduce the quality and quantity of these early life habitats. When you start to lose good functioning early life habitats, that can lead to a recruitment bottleneck. Now, because early life habitats are, we consider them front line of natural reproduction, they're ideal targets for protection, to monitor and evaluate restoration if that's an action that's deemed necessary. And finally, if you can apply the mantra of protecting, monitoring, and enhancing these habitats, you can reduce the need to supplementally stock these populations to sustain these fisheries. But you also have the ability to maintain the genetic integrity of all these subpopulations that are spawning up in all these different tributaries throughout the tributaries of Eastern Lake Ontario. Now, just to emphasize this whole genetic integrity thing, this was a figure that Dr. Chris Wilson and Dr. John Farrell produced their report in 2012 showing the population genetic structure for walleyes from New York State lakes and tributaries, the Canadian waters of Lake Ontario, and the St. Lawrence River and tributaries of Eastern Lake Ontario. And you see that the populations that are geographically more similar have more similar genetics based off of the shading, the lines, and the nodes of those lines. But there is this one little outlier at the bottom here, Mud Creek and Mud Bay. Now, this population branches off from those more associated with the Canadian waters of Lake Ontario. But this is actually a tributary of Eastern Lake Ontario, and the tributary is in New York State. So what was found is that this population has a genetically unique or distinctive population from all the other walleye populations that were sampled in this survey, suggesting that it should receive maybe a little bit more prioritization in terms of its management and protection. And additionally, before this population was identified as distinctive, it was used as broodstock for New York DC. Stocking efforts. So at least 9 sites got stocked from fish from this genetically unique population. So these are just some of the things that you need to keep in mind when you're looking at population from both broad and narrow perspectives. So first thing that I'm really going to get into is what we've done in Eastern Lake Ontario in trying to identify spawning habitats. This has been going on for quite some time, at least until the mid-2000s, but in 2013 and 2014, we went ahead and surveyed sites that had known spawning habitats to monitor, to make sure that they're still producing larval walleye, and also trying to identify novel spawning habitats to increase our repertoire of sites that can be set for monitoring and protection. So we deployed these larval out-migration drift nets in these tributaries to see what we would find. And this occurred at 3 sites with known spawning status and 3 sites with unknown spawning status. The one thing I want to point out is that Frank Flack actually suggested that we look at Skinner Creek and Lindsay Creek because these habitats that looked good, but spawning had not been documented just yet. And after we were done on these surveys over 2 years, all of our sites where we had previously identified spawning habitats continued to produce larval walleye. But we did identify these 2 new sites, Skinner Creek and Upper Kent's Creek. Now, Upper Kent's Creek, even though it's within that tributary that has those unique walleye, that location is about 2.5 kilometers further upstream than any of the previous spawning habitats that were identified as being successful in terms of natural reproduction. Now, it's not just the work that we're doing through SUNY ESF and the Thousand Island Biological Station. The Black River, or the mouth of the Black River, is being targeted as well to try and determine whether or not it's a suitable spawning habitat for walleye. And this is important because the Black River, and this project's being led by Dr. James McKenna, is among the 4 largest tributaries of Lake Ontario. So if this could serve as a significant source of walleye recruitment to the eastern or Eastern Lake Ontario fishery. And it's also really difficult to work in the Black River, and this is a very broad collaboration with multiple organizations, but the efforts or the objectives were to first see if you can't find spawning habitat. Is there successful spawning habitat? And if there is, can we enhance that habitat? And Dr. McKenna was kind enough to give me a little bit of an update of the work that he's been doing on this. And as of 2015 and 2016, they have identified spawning habitats in the Black River. So the next step is to pass that information along to the management agencies and see if they can implement habitat enhancement potentials or structures to evaluate their success. So this kind of leads into the ability to try and identify these habitats, but another important component is to monitor populations. Now, walleye have been reported to have this dialed up migration behavior, and we want to make sure that that was the case in tributaries of Eastern Lake Ontario, just because we wanted to optimize when we are sampling for these larval or these early life stages. So in Chemung River and Little Sandy Creek, we extended our survey during 2013-2014 to have surveys that lasted 30 to 90 minutes, and we repeated these surveys at these locations during daylight and nighttime hours, essentially trying to figure out when do you see the most or higher densities or abundances of larval walleye. And we standardized our catches based off the number of larvae caught per hour that the net was fished, as well as looking at density of larvae by accounting for difference in flow velocities between the two tributaries. And the results were pretty obvious. You end up catching a lot more larval walleye during the nighttime hours. Basically from dusk to about 1 a.m. seems to be the target area. And during the day, it was pretty much stagnant. And we've used a quick comparison, regardless of the metric we use, you're getting much bigger bang for your buck if you survey for larval walleyes at night than during the day. Now this also has implications because you can get a much more robust signal if you optimize your sampling to increase your catchability of your target species or life stage as well. Now we used a lot of the information that we've been compiling for nearly a decade now on walleyes in Eastern Lake Ontario, and we partnered up with the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service's Partners for Fish and Wildlife because of concerns of Kent's Creek through sedimentation and channelization. They installed a Newberry weir downstream of a natural spawning bed. Now the Newberry weir was, to enhance the spawning habitat, it was installed using angular crushed limestone, and it created a engineered riffle to maintain clean substrate to wash off the sediment. And this was installed in 2013, and the approximate location is the dashed rectangular map, and the natural spawning habitat is the solid rectangle in the map there as well. So in 2015 and 16, we evaluated whether or not the habitat enhancement was actually enhancing the habitat for walleye in this section. And we looked at a few different metrics, primarily rates of egg deposition, determining if walleye were spawning at this habitat enhancement structure. Were the eggs at both sites similar in terms of their quality? And also, how did larval out-migration compare between the two sites? Now, the larval out-migration surveys were done at night, and we also isolated the sites from one another using blocking seines to prevent confounding results of upstream larvae drifting into the downstream nets from either site. Now, ultimately, we ended up seeing some pretty positive results from this enhancement structure. In terms of egg catch per unit effort, we ended up seeing more eggs being spawned at the natural site than the enhancement site, and this was consistent for both years. But importantly, there is no difference in terms of egg viability. The quality eggs were basically identical between both sites. But even though there are more eggs being spawned at the natural site, we saw the opposite effect when we looked at larval out-migration. We ended up finding significantly more larval walleye, higher densities, out-migrating from the enhancement site than the natural site, even though there were fewer eggs being spawned there. Now, this increased egg-to-larvae survival at the enhancement site almost seems completely attributable to the substrate that was installed at that location. The enhancement site had substrate that was coarser and significantly smaller than that found at the natural site. And we speculate that this provided smaller interstitial spacing that allowed eggs to get entrained and protect them from potential scour damage and even direct and indirect rates of depredation. So we feel that that had a major impact towards increasing the survival of these early life stages. Now there's also another obvious pattern that you can really see in 2016 is that we didn't catch very much that year. And there seems to be an environmental reason behind that. So we think, or are pretty sure, that walleye abandoned their spawning run in 2016. We started seeing walleye in the section of Kent's Creek that we were studying when water temperatures were about 5 degrees Celsius. That's about when they normally initiate their spawning. The temperatures increased to about 9-10 degrees Celsius, and right about that time, air temperatures or a cold front came through. We had air temperatures that dropped 21 degrees and stayed at incredibly low temperatures for about a week. So water temperatures ultimately dropped to below 4 degrees Celsius, and they stayed at those low temperatures for about a week. And even when water temperatures increased again, which is the open diamond, walleyes and eggs were not seen again. And we were there for quite a few weeks after the temperatures warmed up. So it seems that there was a very abbreviated spawning event in our section of Kent's Creek. Don't know if those fish went somewhere else to spawn and reinitiated them. We just know that where we were looking at it, the walleye left. But ultimately, the question is the enhancement site actually benefiting reproduction for walleye? And this is where monitoring data becomes important, because we can look at our catch rates of larval walleye from 2013 and 2014 before this enhancement structure was installed. And in 2015, the contribution of larvae from the enhancement site pretty much increases the total number, or the abundances, not abundances, but catch rate, to nearly double what was seen previously. And even if you look at 2016, we had low catches, but nearly all of the larvae that we caught came from the enhancement site, suggesting it provides a little bit of a buffer or compensates for the poor reproduction at that location. So just to sum up the importance of early life habitats, when you start looking at identifying and protecting and monitoring these sites, you can identify patterns of reproductions a little bit sooner. It can serve as an early warning system. If you're just basing all of your management decisions on index catches of adults and you have a success of poor year class strengths, it's still going to take probably about another 5 years before we can identify the problem and actually apply any type of remediation action. So this can serve as an early warning system. And also, by evaluating enhancement structures, you can identify the most effective restoration actions for specific locations, so you aren't wasting money on failed endeavors. So evaluation is a very important aspect of any type of habitat enhancement. And towards some of our future work, when you look at it from a more holistic point of view, and you can link reproduction and recruitment by identifying variables that might be predictive of both. So you can develop a little bit more of a expectation of what to expect each year. And we're proposing to do something similar to this with Northern Pike and the Upper St. Lawrence River. And a couple of years ago, we were seining in some open bays in the Upper St. Lawrence River, and we caught a couple of young of the year walleye. We aren't too sure where these walleye came from, but we think that they may have been spawning in open water habitat in the Upper St. Lawrence River. So we're proposing to go out and see if walleye from the St. Lawrence, or actually in Eastern Lake Ontario, are using this alternative spawning strategy. And this would have management implications, because this spawning behavior of open water versus tributary seems to have a genetic component to it. So it seems to be increasing the scope of any type of management plans that are associated with walleye. So with that, I'd like to thank, first of all of you for listening, and all of our numerous partners and organizations and staff, technicians and volunteers over the years. Far too many people to thank individually, so